as a result.
Two of the most famous. I can remember one that
Morning, friends. Welcome.
Welcome
on this wonderful, bright, sunny day that we celebrate Jesus Christ's resurrection. There's a saying that we say, let's see if you know the response. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Okay, we have two options, so. Okay, you want to do it the full way. The tradition is, he is risen, he is risen indeed, he is risen, he is risen indeed, hallelujah. Okay, so let's, he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed,
hallelujah. Excellent, sounds good. Just a couple of announcements to draw to your attention. The first one concerns our lovely decor. I want to take a minute to thank the folks responsible, Carol Van De Winkle and Don McGregor, and Tammy Halpsa.
No,
anyway, let's give them a round of applause. It was quite a beehive of activity after the Good Friday worship as they prepared the sanctuary and got everything ready, so it's just wonderful to have this all. And I want to take a special moment to invite Brian Halls forward. Please come. Because Brian has been responsible for the artwork that we have used throughout Lent. And we have a final Easter picture that will be unveiled at the appropriate time. But let's just acknowledge Brian for the wonderful. Brian's worries has been that this is about him, but let me assure you, Brian, that every comment that I have heard has been about the art. You have been truly honored, and it is our joy to be able to share in it. And now that I've embarrassed you, I'm probably going to pass it down. Thank you. Attention this morning. Our lunch and learn Bible study was being held at Christchurch. We were going for the Lenten services, but we're back in business. So, if you are free on Thursday at lunchtime, we start at 10 minutes after 12. So, those of you who are working can have some time to get here. And we finish at 10 minutes to the hour. It's only 40 minutes long, so that you can have time to get back. Bring your lunch, and we study the Word of God in a very informal way, just up on the couch. with now there are a couple of comfy chairs in the lounge. So you're more than welcome to come and enjoy and share a time together in fellowship. Bring your lunch and share a cup. Let's gather our hearts and minds as we prepare for worship this morning.
Please join us as we sing "Come Into His Presence" and "Gloria."
Jesus, who thanks me, your heart, your voice is raised.
We have been blessed richly by our God. Let's return to God now our gifts. Thursday, and a practice afterwards, and then Good Friday, and then this morning praise. You can proud of yourself, Dad. But thank you all for your yeoman service, and great, it sounds fabulous, doesn't it? Just amazing. So, let's bow our heads together in prayer. Gracious and loving God, as we come before you on this day of celebration, we remember what a joy it is to be your children, to be able to call you our Heavenly Father, our Shepherd, our King, our God, our Creator, our Friend. You have done so much for us, and we want to give you thanks and the praise that you are due. Today, we especially want to thank you for Jesus, for what he has done, what he continues to do, what he will do for us forever. He has saved us, taken us from the depths of our sin, from our pain, from our sorrow, and lifted us up so that we could be back with you, back in a perfect and pure relationship, sinless, ready to go. For this we give you thanks. We give you thanks as well, God, that just as you rose Jesus from the dead and you give us new life, you also give us new opportunities to serve and to be your people. And we pray that today we might have a new start. We ask that you forgive us for whatever has gone before, that you cleanse the slate clean, that you purify us, and that you make us truly worthy to be called your children, to be called your Easter people, celebrating our risen and living Savior. As we come before you, God, we remember the words of Jesus to his people. his invitation that we give up our burdens. And so now, in the silence of our own private prayers, we give those burdens over to you through Jesus. God, you have heard those burdens and you have received them into your hands. And Jesus also invites us to take on new tasks, a new yoke, one that is light and suitable to us. And so we pray now, again in the privacy of our own prayers, that you guide us for today and for tomorrow. Help us to know what it is that you expect of us. God, we receive these gifts willingly, and we ask that you willingly receive this worship and this praise that we are to offer you, for we offer it in the name and in the service of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now I think Anna has some customers for Sunday school, and I'm going to ask Ruth and Rhea to share our first reading. That's it.
God's word, taken from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 to 10. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.' So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'"
I just love this painting so much. I wanted to make it a bit of a sense of occasion on how we ponder Jesus' appearance to the women. And this is our gift from Brian. So I invite you to come forward if you'd like and take a few minutes to ponder his representation. Thank you. policeman interviewing a witness will listen not just for what the witness has seen, but they will also try to figure out if what they are seeing is in line with the witness themselves. Are the words comfortable? From the expressions that they use and the way they sit, are they saying things that are true to them, expressing themselves in ways that are natural? Because if the expression is natural, if the witness talks in a way that seems comfortable and true, then the policeman knows that their testimony is valid. If, on the other hand, they're nervous, if they hesitate, if the words seem uncomfortable in their mouth, then they know that the witness is not necessarily telling the truth. Now, when there are more than one witness taking part in the evidence, in giving the evidence, then the policeman will not only look for the individual's authenticity, but they will listen for repetition. They will listen to see if witness A uses exactly the same words as witness B and witness C. Because if each one of them uses the same phrase, if each one of them tells the story exactly the same way, if each one of them comes off as having read from a script, then they know that at least two of them are lying, right? That they are in collusion, and that they can't believe the testimony of any one of them, because obviously they've gotten together to tell a story and not to reveal what they have witnessed. The interesting thing about our four scriptures, the four gospels that tell the story of Jesus, is that while occasionally they line up and use exactly the same phrase, they quote Jesus as having said exactly the same thing, each story is slightly different from the other. Read through the four Gospels, and you will find that each account reflects a bit of bias. Mark just wants to get the story told. His is the shortest gospel. He uses short phrases. He tells it like a newspaper reporter. Just the facts, man. Who, what, where, when, and why. That's Mark's gospel. Matthew's gospel is directed towards the Hebrew people. Luke is trying to get a whole picture of everything and explain it all in detail. John focuses on Jesus' words and ministry. So each account is unique, and yet they all tell the same story. And when it comes to Jesus' resurrection, they all agree that Jesus was not found in the tomb. They all agree that the women were the first one to discover him gone, but they all have a slightly different twist on it. Here in the gospel that Ruth Ann Rhea read, we heard that there was an angel present explaining things. So if you think back, the policeman looks for accounts that are true to the storyteller. Here we have four accounts that are true to each individual storyteller. The policeman asks, are these people simply reciting a prearranged script? Clearly, in the four unique accounts from each of the gospel, they are not. The accounts are unique and true to the storyteller. The accounts are repeating the same story, but from a slightly different perspective. Apologist Chuck Colson once said that the four gospels are the most reliable testimony, that if they were to come to a court today, if we were to be doing all of this in the legal system, that this evidence provided is more reliable than about 90% of all the evidence provided in major cases where there are convictions. Imagine that. Evidence 2,000 years old is more reliable than a lot of the modern evidence we've heard. What does that mean? That means that what happened on Easter Sunday, what happened that first day after Jesus' resurrection, Jesus' death, is accountable, is verifiable, is true. Jesus rose from the dead. There is no doubt. This is not just some fairy tale. It is not some made-up story. It's not just one person. It's four separate accounts. And in fact, we only have four written accounts, but imagine all of the witnesses. It wasn't just one woman. It was a number of women. It wasn't just one disciple in Galilee. It was a number of disciples. The evidence is rock solid. Jesus is indeed risen from the dead. Jesus lives. There is no doubt. And so all I can say is, He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. I'm going to cut it short, but thanks. Okay, and I'm going to invite Ruth Ann to share with us our second reading.
God's word, taken from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in his mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved.
I ask you to take a few moments just to ponder what it is that Jesus has done for us, for this new life that we have through him. Paul's letter to the Ephesians is one of the classic statements of how we are made alive in Christ. It is one of the go-to texts for preachers to talk about how Jesus has raised us from our death into a new life. Question, however, comes up. Are you alive? Or are you just living? If you get up in the morning, and the first thing you think about is how you're going to make it through the day so that you can go back to bed, you might just be living. If you work hard all day so that you can have more stuff and all of the wealth and all of the stuff you accumulate is never enough, so you work harder, you might just be living. If everything is a chore, if everything seems to be a challenge and no fun, you might just be living. If everything is always, not only is the glass half empty, but the water is dirty and there's a leak in the bottom, you might just be living. See, when Paul wrote to the Ephesians, he was coming at them from the point of view that you full well know that you're alive. Hearts are beating, lungs are working, muscles moving. But he recognized that despite the fact that bodies were alive, the souls were dead. That's the life that God wants for us. It's not just a bodily life. I've got fish in a tank that are perfectly happy to chase each other about and eat when food comes into the bowl. They're just living. That's sometimes I think how God looks at us, is we're so busy running around without any conscious thought of what it is that we're doing. And so Paul says, you know, you guys thought you were alive, but really, you were caught up in all this stuff of the earth. When he talks about sin, he's not talking about the horrible, awful things that other people do. He's talking about the little things that all of us do. Get up in the morning and forget to acknowledge the fact that God just gave us life for another day. Accumulate just enough so we can get by, but forget that some of that stuff that we've accumulated would be nice to share. Love freely, as long as people treat us nice. But that jerk down the street who backed into my garbage can one day, I will never forgive him for that. And that's what Paul's talking about. It's an accumulation of little things, of all these small things that drag us further and further away from God. And the further and further away we get from God, the less we are alive and the more we're just living. So when Jesus rose from the dead, he buried our sins, our mistakes, our errors, the things that distract us from God. He set them so deep into the ground that they can never come out again. However, we can reclaim them. I mean, that's possible. But if you really want to truly live, we have to stop looking at the things of the earth. We have to stop looking at just what it is that's down here. and look up to Jesus. Because where did Jesus go? Jesus was resurrected, appeared before his disciples and his friends and people on the earth, but then he rose to heaven. You can say it out loud, Jesus rose to heaven. And so when we live, it's not about living here on earth. It's about looking up to Jesus and seeing that heavenly life and saying, okay, Jesus, what is it that you want us to do? Well, first thing when you wake up, how about you just acknowledge the fact that God gave you life for another day? Instead of grumbling about the fact, oh, geez, I'm going to be late for work again. Be thankful at least you got work. That you got a breakfast to enjoy. Be thankful even sometimes for the miseries and the pains that are there, because they remind you that you're alive. And if you can't be thankful, if you can't acknowledge that you are alive, if for some reason all this stuff drags you back down, well, here's the joyful thing about the resurrection. Jesus died only once. He rose to heaven only once. But that new life available to him, or to us through him, comes as often as we need it. So every time we're down in the depths, Jesus is willing to pick us back up and make us alive. Every time we mess up and distract ourselves or separate ourselves from God, Jesus is willing to pull us back to him. But there's the key. It's only through Jesus. It's only by our commitment to him. It's only by living with him, through him, and for him that we can be truly alive. So today we celebrate he is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And if we accept him in our heart, we can adjust that. And we can say, we are risen. We are risen indeed. Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, we willingly accept this new life that you have given us. And as we accept this new life, we pray that you help us to be more than just living, but that you help us to be truly alive in Jesus Christ. That you help us to follow his example of love. Love that doesn't look at who it is, but looks at the empty heart and wants to fill it. We look at his example of generosity. Not that Jesus gave away his possessions, but that he gave away his time and his talent to be with people, to serve them as they needed him, to teach them, to challenge them. We pray, God, that we may be alive by serving as Jesus did. And Jesus also brought about forgiveness. Now, we know that it's hard for us to do that we ourselves can't cleanse somebody else. We can't purify them. But we can forgive them, God, and we pray that you help us to be open to forgiving as freely as Jesus was open to forgiving us. And in everything we say and do and are, we pray that others might see us alive in Christ and that they might also see Christ alive in us. In his name we pray. Amen. And join me in our Easter liturgy now, please. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Right, left. Right, left.
We march away from the grave with heads held high. Our sin is dead and buried. Our shame and guilt have been forgotten. We are alive and well through Jesus Christ.
Tick tock, tick tock.
The sun shines brightly, his light and life urging us forward. There is no time to waste. There is new life to be lived. There are Christ-like works to be done. There is good news to be proclaimed.
Right, left, it is time to move on.
It is a new beginning filled with joy and hope. Death has been overcome, sin has been overthrown. In Christ all things are possible. Hallelujah, he is risen. Hallelujah, he is risen indeed.
And we sing together, Jesus Christ is risen today. Of Jesus Christ himself be with you this day and forevermore. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
And together we say, Amen. Amen.